For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey! 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, yes, you have.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything, oh Lord. Your goodness is running after.
Good morning, church. You know, this is the whole idea of church, and I really hate to stop you, but we do have to get started at some point. So, but it's good to see everybody out there. Psalms 30, verse 4 states, "Sing the praises of the Lord, you his faithful people. Praise his holy name." Amen. Amen. Russ?
Good morning. Welcome, everyone, to Bradford Church. We're glad that you're with us today. I'd also like to extend a welcome to any guests that might be among us, and of course, we'll be happy to have you back each and every opportunity you would have to be here with us. I want to share with you some announcements quickly, if I could. First of all, I just want to offer to all of you the same thing I offered on Wednesday evening this past. We're emphasizing the opportunity and the resource of Right Now Media. And if anyone at all is interested in that, but just hasn't been able to tackle it or has had trouble getting into it or whatever, let me know and I will work with you directly to get you logged on and using that resource. And so if that's something that you would like, let me know and I'll work with you to make sure that you have the opportunity to access that wonderful, wonderful resource for us. Choir practice today after second service, so would encourage all of you who would like to be a part of the choir or who are a part of the choir to stick around for that practice today. Ladies of the Lydia Council, you have a meeting tomorrow night at 6:30 in the building next door, and we hope that you will be here for that. It's open to all the ladies of the church, and anyone is absolutely welcome to come, and we want you to do so. Take advantage of that. Also, several activities coming up through the Lydia Council that you can look and be a part of, ladies, and it's in your bulletin, but they'll be talking about those tomorrow night as well. Elders and deacons will be having our monthly meeting Wednesday after Bible study, so if you're a part of the leadership, plan on sticking around or making sure you're here for that meeting. Finally, Fire Pit Fellowship, the first and third Thursday. Of course, that would be this coming Thursday, March 7th. All the fellows are welcome to come and be a part of that. Lots of other things in there you can see, including an Easter schedule that's coming up quickly, and we just want you to be aware. So that's all the announcements I have to share with you this morning. It's time for us to begin our worship together, and I'm going to turn things over to Bill.
You want to do that? All righty, go ahead and be standing, please, if you will. It's not in the bulletin, but we're doing a song by the name of Waymaker. I think we've all probably heard that if you listen to any contemporary Christian music at all. But we've also played it here as well. So and remain standing afterwards, and we'll lead us in prayer.
I worship you. I worship you.
Let's pray. Father, this morning as we gather here today, we thank you for the beautiful day you've given us to be out and about. We're thankful for the opportunity to gather together with those of precious, same precious faith that we can gather together here. Father, we just are thankful that you are a God that is a way maker, a miracle worker, a healer, and just so many things in your word that tells us that you are. And I think each and every one of us can attest to the fact that we've experienced the healing power or the direction and whatever the case may be, Lord. We just ask today that we gather here today, our worship is fitting to you. And as always, if there is anybody here today who needs to give their life to you, they do so before it is eternally too late. We thank you, Lord. We love you and we praise your holy name. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. All right. You may be seated. Our first song this morning is How Great Thou Art. How many of you heard that song before? Pretty common song, isn't it? I wonder how many of you could really, if we could sing it without the screens or the books. Well, I think we probably could get through the first verse, How Great Thou Art. But no, it's a great song. But anyway, we're going to sing the first, third, and last verse. As a matter of fact, if you use a book, it's got a mark there for you. So number 147, How Great Thou Art. Sing it like you mean it.
Oh, Lord, my God, in I am awesome wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to me. How great thou art, how great thou art. And I think that God his Son not sparing, scarce can take it in, that I should bow my burden gladly bearing in His eyes to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Last verse.
When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart when I look in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Let's sing that refrain or chorus a cappella, if we will, to close up.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to me. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
You believe that? Amen. Thank you. All righty, our communion hymn, as we prepare ourselves, what I think is one of the most important parts of our worship time, is going to be number 323, At the Cross. And And Brother Dwayne is going to deliver not only the meditation, but the prayer as well. And he says he has something special for us. Would you call it that? Different. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. All righty. But anyway, like I said, it's I feel a very important time of our worship together. At the cross, we're going to sing the first, second, and last verse.
At the cross where I first saw the light, may the burden of my heart roll away, roll away. It was there by faith I will see my sight, and now I am happy all the day. The second verse. Was it for crimes that I had done? He groaned upon the tree. At the cross, when I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Last verse.
The drops of grief I ne'er repay, the debt of love I owe. Ye Lord, I give myself to thee, it's all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Not sure if it's special or not. We'll see. It'll be a little different. What I'm going to do here in a few minutes, I'm going to ask the servers to come forward, of which I am one, I think, today, and we're going to distribute the communion tray, pass it amongst you. But I would ask you to not partake of it. Just have it in your hand, have it ready. If you want to separate the cups, if you've got self-serving cups, go ahead and maybe peel off the top part to get to the wafer. This will all make sense, hopefully, if I do my job right. Later on, and I'll prompt you. You'll know when it's time to partake. I'll let you know when it's time for that. So if the servers would come forward. When I was a little boy growing up in the Methodist Church in Rutland, We had a lot of traditions, a lot of things about going to church that I remember to this day, all these years later. I remember potluck dinners in the basement. I remember having ice cream socials out on the lawn underneath the sycamore tree in the shade. I remember on my birthday when you were little, you would go up forward and put the chains in the collection plate for however old you were. And you were always kind of nervous because you just didn't want to be in front of the people. And heaven forbid, if you were in the Christmas program, you had a speaking part. If you were lucky, you were a sheep or something. You didn't have to do anything. But I've come a long way since then, so I'm up here doing this today, so I'm not overly scared of speaking in public. But of all those traditions that I remember, I also remember how we had communion. We didn't do it every Sunday like we do here at Church of Christ. And I don't know if it was every quarter or how often it was, but when we did have it, it was very special. It was quite solemn, which is what it's supposed to be. But I remember we had, at our church there, we had the padded curbing of the altar, and the altar probably was 15 feet wide, maybe. And when we come into service that morning, the communion table was already prepared. It was covered with white sheets, and you knew that was today we were going to have communion. And at the proper time, a couple of adults would come forward, and they would remove the cloth and fold it very carefully and gingerly, set it aside. We would all rise, come to the center aisle, and after preacher had said a few words, people would come forward and they would kneel. They would disperse out and kneel at that padded altar, as many as could sit there or kneel there. And then they would partake. They would get up, get back to their seat. Then the next bunch would come forward. However many times you had to do that, till everybody had communion. But that stuck with me all these years. I just knew it was a special thing, which it is. Obviously, it's one of the, as Bill likes to say, it's prepare our hearts and minds and clear our hearts and minds and prepare for that moment. And sometimes it's really hard to do. I mean, in today's world, there's maybe you saw a headline this morning that you just can't get out of your head. The girl that happened to pass, it's hard to put that aside. And sometimes it's the silly stuff that creeps into your head, and I'm as guilty as this as the next person. Maybe you're thinking about what you're going to have for lunch. Maybe you're going to think about the big game coming up soon or something. But we need to really focus and try to put that aside and clear our minds and give Jesus the time that we need to give him to really appreciate what communion is all about. So that's what this whole message is to try to give people an idea of almost like you're there going through it, which is something that I do to helps me keep focused on it. And with that being said, how many of you here might, when I told about the story of how we prepared communion or how we had the ice cream social, did you visualize that? Did you kind of picture that as I told that? I do. Everything, when someone tells me a story, if I'm building a car, if I'm doing a home renovation, I see it before it's done. Or if someone tells me a story, I try to see it as it happens. It helps me to kind of get more into it. So what I thought we would do today is to basically do an exercise to help us put all that clutter away and think about it. So in a few minutes here, I'm going to ask you to close your eyes and bow your head. And we're just going to try to think what it would have been like if you would have been one of the disciples during the Last Supper and what that would have been like. And then I'll say a few verses from Luke here, and then I'll conclude by having the prayer as well at the end of this. So if you would, close your eyes and bow your head. I ask you to take a deep breath and slowly exhale and try to eliminate all the clutter, all the thoughts that are consuming you, that obviously in today's world that just seems to happen. But I want you to kind of vision, perhaps you were one of the disciples, and maybe you were late getting to the Last Supper. And you, as you go through the streets, you hear maybe a dog barking or kids playing. At one point, you pause to take your sandal off because maybe you've got a pebble underneath your sandal that's kind of hurting you. You go up the steps to the upper room. And as you go in, everybody else is there. Everybody's talking, and they greet you warmly. Perhaps come up and give you a hug, see how you're doing. And as you sit there and you're taking all this in, you hear all the sights and the sounds and the smells. Perhaps you smell the bread and some of the other food that's there. And then Christ begins to speak. And he takes, and this is Luke 22, verse 19. And when he had taken some bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." You may partake of the bread. And verse 20 continues, and in the same way, he took the cup after he had eaten, saying, this cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. You may partake of the cup. And as I was preparing this morning, in my Bible here, which is such an awesome Bible, because down at the bottom it gives me more insight into these verses and what they mean. Wanted to read some of that if I could. Christians differ in their interpretation of the meaning of the commemoration of the Lord's Supper. There are three main views. The bread and the wine actually become Christ's body and blood. Two, the bread and wine remain unchanged, yet Christ is spiritually present by faith in and through them. And three, the bread and wine, which remain unchanged, are lasting memorials of Christ's sacrifice. No matter which view they favor, all Christians agree that the Lord's Supper commemorates Christ's death on the cross for your sins and points to the coming of the kingdom of glory. When we partake of it, we show our deep gratitude for Christ's work on our behalf, and our faith is strengthened. Jesus asked the disciples to eat the broken bread in remembrance of me. He wanted them to remember his sacrifice, the basis for forgiveness of sins, and also his friendship that they could continue to enjoy through the work of the Holy Spirit. Although the exact meaning of communion has been strongly debated throughout the years, Christians still take bread and wine in remembrance of their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Do not neglect participating in the Lord's Supper. Let it remind you of what Christ did for you. Let us pray. Lord, we are so grateful and thankful that we have the opportunity to come here together today to worship you. We have lots of freedoms, and that is the best one of all. The communion is a special moment, a special time when we do remember what you sacrificed for us and what you did for us and will continue to do for us. Let us not ever get so busy that we forget its meaning, and just help us to always hold that in great reverence and just use that as the focus and the guide to continue our daily lives. Amen.
May we stand and sing the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Let's take a hand, give a hug, say good morning to those around you. Page 609 will be our invitation hymn, if you'd like to mark that, hold it ready, 609. You can go ahead and take your Bibles this morning, your Bible apps, and turn to Hebrews chapter 10. That will be where our text is coming from today, Hebrews chapter 10. I want you to think for just a moment, if you would, of the best seasons of your life. Just think about the best seasons of your life. I'm talking about the days when you were experiencing the presence of God and walking in victory and, of course, accomplishing your calling. And these seasons that I'm talking about actually have a common denominator. And What that is you were at the same time when this was happening involved in a community of faith. Let me explore that a little further. Yeah, I'm not talking just about going to church, even though that's important and we're going to discuss that. I'm talking about you actually being in a relationship with people who walked with you, worked with you, prayed with you, and shared your wins and losses with you. I'm saying that during these seasons in which your life has been at its best, the common thread has been your connection to other Christians. Conversely, during the worst seasons of your life, and now I'm talking about the days when you struggled with doubt and uncertainty, when you struggled with obedience, and when you struggled to be faithful to your calling, these seasons also have a common denominator. During these seasons, you weren't involved in a closely connected community of faith. Again, I'm not talking just about church attendance. In fact, probably very many of you in here today have been in church most Sundays all your life since you were born. But I bet you haven't always been closely connected to other Christians. Too many times we have tried to be the Lone Ranger with one missing detail. As the old saying goes, even the Lone Ranger had Tonto. But there's been times when you've tried to go it alone, even without Tonto to help you out. Now, I learned this morning, and I had a couple of young people in the first service. The truth of the matter is, we have some young people sitting in here today have no idea who the Lone Ranger and Tonto is. Look it up. Google it. You know, there's been times when you've tried to endure all that life brings your way and do so all by yourself. When you've tried to make decisions on your own and tackle your problems on your own and face the future on your own, and guess what? It never works out. It's not supposed to work out because that's not how God made us. He made us to live in community with one another. Now, in today's culture, the possibility is greater than ever before us to live isolated and detached lives. But we weren't made to live in isolation. We were made to live in community. This is especially true of the Christian life. In order to thrive spiritually, we need to be connected to others, sharing our lives with others, surrounded by fellow believers who are as committed to us as we are to them. John Wesley said, "The Bible knows nothing of solitary religion." And so in spite of that, many Christians try to live out their faith solitarily. In other words, outside the context of the Christian community. Why do we need to go to church? Bill Gates has publicly stated more than once that he believes in God and that he has great value. He sees great value in religion. And in an interview with Time magazine, he said this. He said, "In terms of allocation of time resources, religion is not very efficient. There's a lot more I could be doing on Sunday morning." Now, I'm not trying to criticize Mr. Gates. In fact, I admire the foundation that he has and the money he is giving away to help with problems found around the world. But I do disagree with him on this point. I do believe that he used the word religion, and I mean being involved in a community of Christians, is an excellent allocation of time resources. In fact, I would say that if you're not connected in this way to other believers, then you're not making the most of your time and you're not getting the most out of life. This is the last week of our series called Glory Days, and of course we've been talking about how to make this time that we're in right now the time of your life. And in our final session of this series, today we're going to talk about the principle of reciprocity. And you might ask, well, what is reciprocity? I've heard that word many times, but what does it mean actually? Well, it's actually the practice of exchanging things with others for mutual benefit. That's one of the key advantages of being connected to a community of believers. We build each other up. Many people look at church as a place to get their needs met. If the music doesn't hit them right, though, it doesn't fill them at the right spot, or if the sermon doesn't hit them in the right spot, then they say, well, you know, I'm just not getting fed. I'm not getting what I need. Maybe I should move on to another church. I know of a lot of people who spend their entire Christian lives moving from one church to another, trying to find that perfect place that keeps their spiritual tummy full and their spiritual diaper dry. We call them church hoppers, and it's really not a compliment, is it? The problem is no church can ever do it to their satisfaction. So every year or so, they get disgruntled and they move on to another place. So let me make this clear. You should go to a church where you're getting fed spiritually. No question about that. However, if your attitude is only and always gimme, 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 you'll never be satisfied in any church. No matter how big or how slick their services are or how well-known their preacher is, when people talk about getting their spiritual needs met, they often overlook one of the greatest spiritual needs of all, and that is this. You need to be needed in order to thrive. You need to be needed. You need to be plugged in to a group, not only to meet your spiritual needs, but whose spiritual needs you are able to meet as well. Of course, we've been looking at this passage, Hebrews 10, verses 19 through 39, and that's where we are today. And this passage of Scripture actually gives us four reasons why it's a good idea to be as involved as you can in the local church. You notice I said four reasons. That means that today is not a three-point sermon. It's a four-point sermon. It's a bonus point. Isn't that great? You all been so good that I decided you deserved a bonus point. And these four ways in which the principle of reciprocity works need to be at work in our lives. And so let's take a look at them. And the first thing I want you to see this morning is this. We need to encourage one another. That's not a surprise, probably, that you've heard that before, but we need to encourage one another. Verse 25 of our text says this, not forsaking our own assembling together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another. Some translations, probably the NIV, many of you have, it says, let's not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing. A report from the National Institute of Mental Health arrived at this conclusion, said many of our daily conversations are actually mutual counseling sessions whereby we exchange the reassurance and advice that helps us deal with routine stresses. And so that's what it means for us to encourage one another, and that's what each of us needs. You need a place where you can be encouraged. And just as importantly, if not more importantly, we need to be where you can be a source of encouragement to others. Anybody recognize the name Truett Cathy? He is the founder of Chick-fil-A. Almost tempted to stop and give him a round of applause. I think most of us probably are fond of Chick-fil-A. And he once said this, how do you identify someone who needs encouragement? You know what the answer was to that? If they're breathing, they need encouragement. We all need encouragement. So that, for that reason, we need to be encouragers. That's our responsibility. John Maxwell tells about the difference between firelighters and firefighters. Firelighters go out of their way to help you keep the fire hot. Firefighters go out of their way to throw cold water on you. Now, you want to avoid the firefighters when you can, but more importantly, you want to be a firelighter at every opportunity. So let me ask you this morning, how long has it been since you've said to someone here at the church, hey, great job, you did a great job with that, or way to go, just keep up the good work? And I'm not just talking about the preacher or the paid secretary. I'm talking about the leaders of the church. I'm talking about the nursery workers and the youth volunteers. I'm talking about the Sunday school teachers. I'm talking about the greeters, the people who prepare communion, the people who sing in the choir, the people who play the piano, and the people who come in and clean up after we've come and gone, and all that mess that we've left. There are people all around who need your encouragement. So let's just make it a point that we are going to encourage one another. And this brings me to the second way in which the principle of reciprocity should be at work among us, and that's this. We need to challenge one another. We need to challenge one another. Verse 24 says, "And let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds." Maybe your translation says, "Spur one another on to love and good deeds." And when the writer of Hebrews says that we need to stimulate one another or spur one another on, he's saying that we need to be willing to give others a kickstart in the right direction. Now, some people hear that term and they think, well, that kickstart means that we get to berate or humiliate someone until they stop being lazy and start doing what they need to do. But that's not what I'm talking about at all. In fact, a good example of what I'm talking about can be seen in the website called Kickstarter.com. Has anyone ever heard that website? Kickstarter is a crowdfunding platform that invites people who have to get behind good ideas that somebody's wanting to start up but needs a little money to do so. And it's been tremendously successful. People just contribute a small amount of money, but enough of it's collected to get this good idea off the ground, and it turns out to be wonderful. Many projects have been funded using this resource. And so when I say that we need to give one another a kickstart to stimulate one another or spur one another on toward love and good deeds, I'm saying that our attitude needs to be, how can I help you move forward? How can I help you move forward? You know, as we look around us, as we see the ministries and activities that take place here at Bradford Church and the people who are involved in each area of the ministries and activities here, the question that we need to be asking is this, who needs my help? And what can I do to help them? It's really, really easy to complain about what's wrong with this area of the church or that area of the church or what's wrong with this person who's in leadership or that person who's in leadership. And as the saying goes, any fool can criticize, and most fools do. But here's my challenge to you. Rather than criticizing or slurring one another, let's focus instead on spurring one another toward love and good deeds. And let's remember that stimulating or spurring means that you approach the person or you approach the situation by asking, what is it I can do to help you? How can I help you? What resources do I have that can be used to move things forward? Now, this brings me to the third way in which the principle of reciprocity should be, and that's the fact that we need to comfort one another. You might remember these verses that we looked at a couple of weeks ago. Look at verse 33 of our text. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. For you showed sympathy to the prisoners and accepted joyfully the seizure of your property, knowing that you have for yourselves a better possession and a lasting one. Now, one thing is certain. At one time or another, each and every one of us has faced and will face hard times. It's just a fact of life. It's going to happen. And though these hard times are inevitable, no one should have to face these hard times all by themselves, should they? They shouldn't have to face it alone. We should be there for one another. The ancient Greek physician Hippocrates, after whom is named the Hippocratic Oath, said this: cure sometimes, treat often, and comfort always. Cure sometimes, treat often, and comfort always. So this is how we can apply that quote to our spiritual lives. I'd like to share that with you. Sometimes when someone is hurting, we are able to provide a cure. I mean, we are able to actually fix the situation for them. We are able to make the pain go away because we have the resources at our disposal to do so. And so when we can provide a cure, when we can provide a solution for someone who's facing hard times, then you should do it. That's your responsibility. You should do it. Now, there are times when we might not have the resources available to provide a cure, but we can actually help with the treatment. A good example of this is the story of a fellow named David. I think I've told this story in a previous sermon. He was without a car, David was, and he did not have the resources to buy one. So a couple of his neighbors helped with the treatment. They couldn't buy a car for him, but they were able to do this much. One neighbor would give David's children a ride to and from school each day, and the other neighbor would give David a ride to work, to and from work each day. And they did this for two whole months until David was able to assemble the resources and be able to buy a car for himself. When someone is facing difficult or hard times, you may not be able to make the problem go away, but you may be able to treat it a little bit. Sometimes we can offer a cure. Often we can help with the treatment. And then there are times when people go through situations where we are able to do absolutely nothing except be there for them. That's our way of providing comfort. Even when you don't have a cure, even when you can't help with the treatment, you can always be there to comfort others, can't you? For example, there's the story of Bob and his friend who experienced an unimaginable tragedy. The man's entire family was murdered. And so Bob went to see his friend, but he didn't have a clue what to say to his friend. So he decided that he would just say nothing. He just stayed with his friend, took care of him, fixed his meals, and talked only when his friend talked to him. He didn't try to put the tragedy into perspective for him because he knew that he couldn't. So he just silently stood by, and his friend later told him, "That's what got me through this ordeal, that you were just there and you let me grieve silently." There are times when people go through things that we can't fix or that we can't even offer much help, but that we can only say, "I'm sorry, I care, and I'm here." So we need to do this for one another. Now, here's the fourth and final way in which the principle of reciprocity should be at work among us, and that's this. We need to overcome with one another. We need to overcome with one another. I love the final verse of Hebrews chapter 10. Look at verse 39 of our text. He says, "But we are not of those who shrink back to destruction, but of those who have faith to the preserving of the soul." Now, you might not be a fan of the Notre Dame Fighting Irish, but one thing you would have to admit, their fans and their players take pride in their tradition and their identity as a top-tier team in college football. Even when they lose, they still see themselves as winners. In each game day, moments before kickoff, as the players leave the locker room, they pass under a sign hanging over the doorway at the bottom of their locker room stairs. And the tradition is that each player reaches up to hit the sign before they run onto the field and remind themselves who they are and why they're here. And the sign says, "Play like a champion today." That's what the sign says. The writer of Hebrews is saying the very same thing to us. Live life like a champion, because that's who we are. We don't shrink back. We don't give up. We don't run away. We hold on to our faith and hang in there until the very end. I know that there are times when each and every one of us just want to give up and quit. And if you're living like the Lone Ranger, you just might do it. So that's why we need each other, so that we can continue to remind one another that we are on a winning team, that we are overcomers. We are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ, Scripture tells us. We don't shrink back. We move forward together toward victory. And so that's what the principle of reciprocity is, that together we strive to bring out the best in one another. We encourage one another. We help one another. In times of trouble, we're there for one another, and we remind one another at every opportunity that together we are destined to overcome whatever it is that life might bring our way. And so if you want these days to be your glory days, then you surround yourself in Christian community. Does that make sense? Make it your mission to bring out the best in others and to let others make sure that it brings out the best in you. Let me close. So we wrap up this series today, and I just want to take a quick look at what we've talked about together the last 4 weeks. In week one, we talked about renewal. You can be as close to God as you want to be, but it's up to you to draw near to Him. In week two, we talked about reconnection. Whenever you're ready, you can pick up where your best days left off. Because if you did it then, guess what? You can do it again, and you can do it now. Last week, we talked about resolution. We talked about the determination to go the distance. It's either your towel or your hat. Every day, you choose which one you're going to throw into the ring. And today, we talked about reciprocity. Surround yourself with believers who are as committed to you as you are to them. Make it your mission to bring out the best in others and let others bring out the best in you. If you and me as individuals and all of us together as a church will put these principles into practice, these days will be our glory days, and this time will be the time of our lives. Amen? That's my message this morning. We want to offer the invitation today because there might be somebody here who needs to give their life to Jesus Christ, to surrender to Him and be immersed through Christian baptism so that they may receive the forgiveness of their sins and the gift of God's Holy Spirit. Maybe there's someone here who's done that previously and you need to rededicate yourself because you have wandered away from the faith and from doing what you know you need to do. Do you happen to be looking for a church home? We'd love to be your church home. Or do you just simply need prayers today? Do you need the prayers of the church because you are going through a hard time, a difficult time? You don't know what to do. You're lost in this situation. Let us help us. Let us help you, and if we can provide the cure, we will. Amen? We'll help you. And if we can provide some treatment, or if we can provide comfort, that's what we will be willing to do for you. Let's stand together. Let's sing the first and last verse of Know Not One, please. We do have Lydia Council taking place tomorrow night at 6:30 in the Activity Building. All ladies of the church are invited to attend, okay? We'd just love to have you over there for that special group. Of course, Fire Pit Fellowship, Thursday evening at 7 o'clock. We have Wednesday Bible study where leadership will have their meeting following the evening service that evening. Evening. How many times am I going to say evening? All right. Is there anything else, though, that needs to be announce before we depart? Yes, Sherry?
Today is my sister-in-law's birthday.
pay. Let's keep her and that family in our prayers. Go ahead. Okay. Gotcha. Right. First of all, repeat what she's saying. What's it called again? Batangas down in Middleport. They are offering to athletes. So if you have a child or a grandchild who's an athlete, they're doing free EKGs and just doing a general checkout. And that is a very important thing. The little girl by the name of Brielle Remy, who was only 10 years old, collapsed at a basketball practice, and then she did die yesterday evening. So you pray for that family as they go through a horrible nightmare of an experience. So, and, of course, take advantage of this offering that the community has to your young people who are athletes. It's important. So I will mention... Yeah, the stepmother and the father. Well, the stepmother has attended. I don't remember the father coming, but the stepmother has attended here previously, and other families. So keep that in your prayers, and we'll see what we can do to be of help to them. I want to mention Ron Henning. You might notice he's not here with us this morning. Ron is under the weather and has been since yesterday, so he missed first service and he's just trying to get better, so you keep him in your prayers. And for those of you who did not know, my mother fell down, her and her rollator fell down about 3 steps onto a concrete floor, and she landed on top of that rollator. She broke 2 ribs, and she has broken her wrist severely. It will have to have surgery tomorrow to repair, and there's just... other complications that go with anesthesia and being having dementia and Alzheimer's and that sort of thing. So we have some worries trying to get this all figured out. She is in the hospital and probably will be in a nursing service facility for a period of time as she recovers. So you lift her up in your prayers. Our goal is we want to bring her home. We don't want her to stay in a facility. So you pray about that, that that can happen, okay, for her sake. So that's all I have to bring up. Unless anybody else has anything to say, we're going to close with prayer. Choir practice. Plan on sticking around for choir practice. All right. Will you bow with me, please? Father in heaven, we're so grateful that we were able to assemble here today. What a joy, what a blessing it is for us to be able to bring praise and honor and glory to your name. I hope that that's exactly what we've done, that it has been pleasing to you. Father, we thank you for the challenge that is found in your word, where we would make sure that we seek to encourage one another, to provide comfort to one another, to provide help to one another. Father, we want to do exactly that as we live our Christian life, that we are living it in community, that we understand that we need and depend on one another. It's we like to think in our culture that it's great to be independent, but that's not what we're called to in our Christian faith. We are called to be a part of a community of believers. Remind us of that, Father, and convict us where we need to be convicted in that regard. And of course, Father, as we depart from here, may we go out and be a blessing to others in your name, and may we live out these things that from Hebrews chapter 10, Father, that you would have us to live out in our spiritual lives. And we pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, whom we praise and thank you for. Amen.
Trusted you and stepped out on